Hello everyone, welcome to the corporate finance world. In module 1, we will cover financial management and valuation concept and security valuation. So let's see in agenda what we have. We will cover the definition of finance, business finance and financial management, which will be followed by objective and scope of financial management. We will also cover the concept of liquidity versus profitability, time value of money, valuation concept, and then we'll see the calculation, how we do for evaluation of assets, debentures, preference shares, and equity shares. So let's start. Definition. Finance is provision of money. The finance function may be defined as the efficient procurement of funds and their effective utilization. So it's very important to know that we need to procure the funds efficiently, and then not only procurement, we need to do effective utilization of them. Business finance, which we can also say as corporate finance, it can be defined as the activity concerned with planning, raising, controlling, and administrating of funds used in business. Financial management. Financial management is the proper management of funds. It may be defined as devoting managerial efforts to the management of funds of the enterprise, both its sources and users. Sources is basically related to the procurement, and then users is the effective utilization, which we talked when we learned the finance definition. Coming to the next slide, we will cover the objective of financial management. Financial management objectives are maintenance of adequate liquid assets. So it's very much needed and necessary for a financial manager that an entity must have enough liquidity assets to meet its obligations. And the concept of liquidity and profitability will come into the picture when we try to achieve this objective. In upcoming slide, we will see the concept of liquidity and profitability. The next objective is profit maximization. Profit maximization is not a very, good objective, because it is under severe criticism because it is vague, it's ignored timing, and also overlooked the aspect of future activity. It is vague because it doesn't explain whether the objective is short-term and long-term. And for example, if a firm continue to run its business without maintenance of its machinery, then they may have profit, which is more because they are not charging the depreciation in the profit and loss account. However, in the long run, if we see, there will be high cost in the replacement of machinery and repair. So that is what we say, that profit maximization is vague because it doesn't give clarity of short term and long term. Another aspect, it is ignored timing, because it ignores the fact that rupee recovered today is much more valuable than a rupee received tomorrow. So the time value of money, which we will understood in later slides also, the profit maximization objective doesn't, cover that time value of money. It also overlooked the quality aspect of future activity. Like, some firms place a high value of growth of sales rather than high profit, because they want to have high market share and also want to gain sustainability by the large volume of sales. Now, the main objective, which is the next objective of financial management, is wealth maximization. It is the maximization of net present worth. Any financial action which creates wealth and which has the net present worth above zero should be undertaken. Another objective is fair return to shareholders. It may be defined as or termed as return on equity. It is a financial ratio that measures how effective a company is at generating income compared to the shareholders' contribution or shareholders' fund. Ensuring maximum operational efficiency. So by efficient and effective utilization of finance, we are able to meet this objective. And another objective is building up reserve for growth and expansion. So these were the objective of financial management. Moving to the next slide, which will cover the scope of financial management. So this is very important to know what is the total scope of financial management, because this is the whole curriculum or the topics which we will cover eventually when we cover the corporate finance course altogether. But to understand the scope of financial management, the scope of financial management is the wise use of funds by looking at financial problems of an entity in an analytical way and by taking financial decisions with the target to achieve financial goals which an enterprise sets for itself. So we talked about like financial problems. We need to do the analytical way to try to know what are the problems, and then we need to have decisions around them. So the main content of financial problems are: what is the total volume of fund an enterprise should commit? What specific assets should the enterprise acquire? And what should the funds require to be financed? Now these questions, when comes into the picture, that leads to four broad decision areas or financial decision areas of financial management. The four decision areas are fund requirement decision, financing decision, investment decision, and dividend decision. The fund requirement decision is basically to estimate that how much fund a company or an entity required and take into account both for the fixed requirement or the working capital requirement. This will later on help us to understand the concept of capitalization, and in our course we will later on in one of our module will cover what capitalization is and detail around capitalization. Another decision area will be financing decision. This involves identification of sources from which funds can be raised. So sources could be like raising equity capital in the market, debentures, or the preference shares and all that, or we can take loan from bank and all. These were the sources. The amount can be used for each source and the cost involved. This leads to the concept of capital structure. So an entity generally have on the liability side the whole capital structure, which will include the equity share, the debentures, loan, other sense of, you know, long liabilities and all. Then we come to the next decision, which is investment decision. This involves decision relating to investment in capital and current assets. For investment in capital assets, evaluate different capital investment proposals and select the best among them. The investment in current asset will depend upon the credit and inventory policy which is pursued by the enterprise. This will come to the concept of capital budgeting and working capital management, which we'll cover in detail in our other modules. Dividend decision is also one of the important decisions because it involves the determination of percentage of profit which is earned by an enterprise and which they want to pay to the shareholders. So this will be the dividend policy concept, which will also cover our course of corporate finance. Very important slide to understand and to know that there could be multiple concepts which we will learn later on also in detail. Moving to the next slide now. The concept of liquidity versus profitability. Remember, you know, when we covering the objective of financial management, there was maintenance of adequate liquid assets, where we say that we need to have balance between liquidity and profitability. Now we understand this concept. What is liquidity and what is profitability? Liquidity means that the firm has adequate cash to pay its obligation, to pay its liabilities. The firm has sufficient cash to make unexpected large purchases, and the firm has sufficient cash to meet any emergency at any time in the organization or in an entity. On the other hand, profitability is the fund of the firm are used in such a way that it gives maximum profit or yield at the higher return. So a very important note will come up here that there is inverse relationship between liquidity and profitability. For an example, let's understand that if higher inventories are kept with an anticipation that the price of raw material will increase in the market later on, then the profitability goal is approached. But the liquidity of the firm is in danger because we have already blocked our money in the inventory, which we could have, you know, in the liquid form. This concept leads to a concept of risk and return trade-off also, because the higher the risk, the higher the return. This we generally know. So So higher risk endanger but your liquidity of the firm, while higher return increase the profitability. So for any finance manager, and we are all, you know, in field of finance, we need to maintain risk return trade-off level to have the best, you know, approach towards the liquidity and profitability. The level where both return and risk are optimized is the best level. So at this level, market value of the company share would be maximum. Now we move to the next slide, which will talk about the time value of money. What, you know, what we understand that money has time value because of following reasons. Like for example, like individual prefer having current consumption of the money rather than having the same money in future. The another reason of money that have the time value is that investor can profitably employ a rupee received today to give him a higher value that, you know, if he receives the same tomorrow. And in an inflationary economy, the money received today has more purchasing power than we receive in the future. So this is the reason that time value, but that money has a time value in it. Thus, the concept behind the time value of money is that the sum of money received today is worth more than the same is received after some time or a later period. For example, if an individual won a prize of 20,000 rupees, and have the option to receive it either today or after the year, he will prefer to have it now. Because first thing, there will be no risk of getting money back later on, which he if he have already with him, then higher purchasing power due to the inflation. And also, he may invest that money and get the opportunity cost of interest. So these are the reasons which help us to understand, yes, that money has time value. Now we come to valuation aspect, which is unit 2, valuation. So valuation in finance is the process of estimating the value or the worth of a firm or a security or an investment, or you can say an asset, anything. So whenever we try to take or evaluate or value the worth of anything, that is covered under valuation, wherein value depends upon the required rate of return and the time period over which this return is expected to receive. So we will cover the valuation, as you can see on your slide, we will cover the valuation of assets, then we will cover the valuation of debentures, valuation of preference shares, and valuation of equity shares. Here I would like to highlight that when we do the valuation of debenture and valuation of shares, so the debentures and shares or preference shares could be of two types. Irredeemable debentures or redeemable debentures. Similarly, irredeemable preference shares and redeemable preference shares. Right. So now we come to the valuation of asset. Asset is a tangible object or intangible right owned by an enterprise. So intangible right could be like trademarks, patents, copyrights, royalties, and all. They are intangible rights. If an enterprise have an asset, either intangible form or the intangible right which they own, and carrying probable future benefit out of it, then we can calculate the value of asset depends upon how much probable future benefit will get out of it. So the value of asset will be equal to the present value of the benefit associated with that asset. Symbolically, we can say the current value of asset will be equal to the annual cash inflow, and when we apply annuity discount factor at the appropriate interest rate. Let's understand this with an example. If an investor expects an annual return of rupees 1,000 for next 10 years from an asset, and interest rate in market or interest rate is 15%, then the current value of asset will be 1,000, which is the annual cash inflow, and we multiply the same with the annuity discount factor for the 10th year. Then we come out to the value of, in this case, 5019. So it's very simple to get the valuation of assets. Now we move to the valuation of debenture. We need to understand what debenture is. Debenture is a formal document constituting acknowledgement of a debt by an enterprise, usually given under a common seal. So it is debt basically for a corporate or for an entity. Debenture holders are entitled to receive two things. One, interest at the fixed rate till maturity, and at the time of maturity, the principal amount of the debenture. So when we do the calculation in case of debenture or do the valuation of debenture, the two things will come in picture. One, the interest which we will receive till the maturity will happen, and another thing, the principal amount will get back at the time of maturity. So this can be, principal can be at the discount or at premium, which will be the another aspect to it. But then formula, we'll come to the formula now. So the value of bond or a debenture will be equal to the interest payable on the bond multiplied by with annual discounting factor applied to the interest plus the face value, or you can say the principal amount of debenture which you will receive at the maturity will be multiplied by the appropriate discount factor applicable to the face value at the year of maturity. Let's understand this through our example. We have a debenture of rupees 100 with interest at rate of 15. So 15 rupees will be the interest which we will receive till the maturity of that debenture. And it is given that it will become due for repayment after 5 years. So 5 years is the time for the repayment. Required rate of return in the market is deemed 10%. So now debenture current value will be 15, which is the interest, multiplied by the annuity discount factor applicable to the interest, which is at the rate of 10%, because the rate of interest is 10%, which is 3.791, and then plus the face value, which is 100, which we will receive after 5th year. So we multiply the same with the appropriate discounting factor applicable to the face value, which is 0.621, and this calculation helps us and lead to the value of debenture at the present value of debenture, which is 119. I just want to make you clear that these present value factors or the discounting factors, annuity discount factors, we have defined tables for these factors which give you what is the value after 4 years, 5 years, 1 year, over the period of time. And this can be calculated over the calculator also, if you have the scientific calculator or the normal calculator, right? So now we come to the valuation of perpetual debentures, which is irredeemable debentures. Remember when we were mentioned initially that debentures of two types, it could be perpetual or it could be redeemable. So now we have to do the perpetual debentures, or what are the perpetual debentures? Perpetual debentures are debentures which will never mature. So we don't have their maturity value, or when they're going to mature. So in this case, the value of debenture will be depends upon the expected rate of interest or expected rate of, expected income, what we are expecting from it. So the annual interest will be considered over here and divided by the expected rate of interest will help us to give the value of debenture. For example, a debenture holder is to receive an annual interest of rupees 100 for perpetuity on his debenture of rupees 1000. So we have debenture which is value of 1000. We are receiving interest 100 rupees. That means rate of interest is 10%. And required rate of return is 15%. That is, in the market, the rate of return is 15%. Although on the debenture, we are receiving 10% in rate of interest. Thus, the value of debenture will be 100, which is the annual interest which we are receiving, divided by 15%. So the present market value of the debenture is 667. Now we come to the valuation of redeemable debenture. Redeemable debenture is which will be redeemed after a fixed period, and then we will get its value or the maturity value at the time of maturity. Then the yield of debenture, how to calculate the yield or the interest on it? So yield will be the annual interest payment plus the face value minus the present value of the debenture divided by the period of debenture to maturity. And this will be further divided by the average of face value and the present value of debenture. I want to highlight that, when we understand all these formulas, then the question could be the calculation of the value of debenture, the question could be yield on debenture. So they can ask you the question around either sometime calculate the percentage or the interest rate. Sometimes they want you to ask you the value of debenture. So you just need to see what information is missing and accordingly apply this formula and do the further calculation. For example, the current market price of debenture of X Limited is Rs. 800. Having a face value of Rs. 1000, the debenture is redeemable after 5 years and it carries an interest rate of 12%. Now we need to calculate the yield on maturity of debenture. So we'll apply the same formula and we'll come to the percentage that it is the yield to the maturity of debenture is 17%. Now we come to the valuation of preference shares, and if you understood the valuation of debentures, then we are already done with the preference shares because the preference shares valuation is 100% same as the valuation of debentures because they also are redeemable or irredeemable, and in addition to it, on preference shares also which carry a fixed dividend rate. There in debenture it was a fixed interest rate, but in preference shares we have fixed dividend rate. So we have, you know, I have covered an example here with respect to preference shares, the calculation of it, where the face value of the preference share is Rs. 100, dividend rate is 10%, so we're going to get 10 rupees on this 100 rupee preference share. Current market price is 15% and maturity is over the period, over 10-year period. So the value of preference share will be 10, the interest amount, or here we can say the dividend amount will be multiplied by the annuity discount factor at the rate of 15% after 10 years, which is 5.19, plus 100, which is the face value of the debenture, multiplied by the 15%, the discount factor at the rate of 15% at the 10th year, which is 0.247. So the value of preference share in this case is Rs. 74.89. Now we come to the valuation of equity share, which is last, not the least, and is really a very important topic and good to understand because equity shares, as we know, that do not carry a fixed dividend or interest rate. Equity shareholders, it may be the case they may receive dividend or may not receive the dividend if the company have a retention policy and they want to have retained their profits to increase the value of the company in the market. So it could be the case that even equity shareholders may not receive dividend. Due to this reason, there are two methods of valuation in case of equity share. One is dividend capitalization method and second is earning capitalization method. So in case when the equity shareholder are receiving dividend, then we apply the dividend capitalization method. And in case if they are not receiving dividend, then we do the calculation on the basis of earnings, earning of that entity or the corporate in which the person has investments and all. Then we apply the earning capitalization approach. Dividend capitalization approach is when the value of an equity share is equivalent to the present value of future dividend plus the present value of price which we are expecting to realize at the time of resale. In case of earning capitalization approach, the value of an equity share can simply be determined by capitalizing the expected earnings because we don't have any maturity value over there, and also we don't know, like, you know, there is no dividend amount which we are receiving on it. So we just capitalize the expected earning and we will get the value of equity share. Now we see or understand both of these approach in detail. First, dividend capitalization approach. Dividend capitalization approach has two assumptions. First, that dividend are paid annually. And secondly, that dividend is received after the expiry of the year of purchase of equity share. Having these two assumptions, there are two valuation methods which we use in the dividend capitalization approach, which could be single period valuation method and multi-period valuation method. Now we need to understand what is single period valuation method and multi period valuation method. We'll cover this in the next slide. Single period valuation method, when we presume that the investor expects to hold the equity for 1 year only. So in that case, the value of the current price of the equity share will be dividend per share, which we are expecting at the end of first 3 year, because we are expecting it to hold it only for 1 year, plus the expected market price of that share in the market at the end of first year, and we divide by 1 plus the required rate of return, or you can say we divide it by capitalization rate. See an example of it. An individual holds an equity share giving him an annual dividend of rupees 20, and he expects to sell that share at the end of the year for rupees 180. Required rate of return is 12%. Now the value of share will be 20, which is the annual dividend, plus 180. 180 is the expected market price of the share at the end of first year, which will be divided by 1 plus required rate of return. Required rate of return is 12%. Then the value of share will become out to be rupees 178 rupees 57 paisa. This was the single period valuation method. Now we see the multiple period valuation method, and what we mean by it, that the equity share have no maturity value. There we hold it for 1 year. Here we don't know that how long we're gonna hold it. So here we, what we do, that current value of equity share will be expected annual dividend, because we are receiving dividend per equity share, divided by the capitalization rate. As an example, like A Limited is expected to pay dividend rupees 40 per share every year, and capitalization rate is 15%. Then the present value of equity share will be 40 divided by 15%, which is rupees 267. Now growth in dividend. Just so far, you know, in these examples, you must have seen or, you know, feel that we have presumed that dividend per share remains constant every year. We received dividend as in first example, rupees 20 every year annually, and in second example, we have seen that we received dividend of rupees 40. But however, this is unrealistic, right? Because earning and dividend of most companies grow over time, at least because of the retention policy. So it could be the case that companies retain the, you know, earning with them and they're not pay out dividend, or it could be the case that a dividend in first year they pay 20 rupees and next year they were having high profits, so they give, you know, liberal dividend or 30 rupees or 50 rupees. So then growth in dividend may be constant or it could be variable year after year. This is the concept of growth in dividend, and this is very, you know, important concept, but an exam, because in examination also there will be questions around growth and dividend, how you explain it, how you understand it, and the questions around it. So growth and dividend. So how the growth and dividend can be calculated? The retained earning into rate of return. For example, a company has share capital of 500,000. The company retains 60% of its earning, and rate of return of the company is 10%. Now the growth in dividend will be, which is like 60%, which is retained earnings into what is our rate of return, the company is 10%. So 60 into 10, which is like 6%. So 6% is the growth of dividend which is happening in this company. But in case of, so we have, like, you know, understood that it could be constant growth or it could be variable growth. In case of constant growth, the dividend calculation, or how we calculate the current market price of equity share, which will be current market price of equity share equal to dividend at the end of the year, and we divided by the capitalization rate minus the growth rate in dividend, which we just understood that how the growth rate of dividend is calculated, which is retained earning into rate of return. So we'll take an example to understand this clearly. Like X Limited is expected to pay a dividend of rupees 40 per share. Dividends are expected to grow perpetually at 10% and capitalization rate is 15%. So the value of share will be 40, which is the dividend amount, divided by 15%, and we deduct the growth rate of dividend. And the growth rate of dividend is, which is given as 10%. And capitalization rate is 15%. The value of equity share will come out to be 100. Now we come to the earning capitalization approach, which we understood that it could be the case that on equity share, the shareholders may not be getting the dividend, and it's just that then in that case, we need to do the calculation on the basis of earning. So in this approach, the value of equity share can simply be determined by capitalizing the expected earnings. So what we do, the current value of equity share will be equal to the expected earning per share divided by the capitalization rate. For example, earning per share of X Limited is rupees 10. Capitalization rate is 20% and retained earning is nil. Thus, the value of share will be 10 divided by 20%, which is the capitalization rate. It is 50 rupees. So we are done with the valuation of debentures, SAs, preference shares, and also equity shares. And we have also understood the basic around what is financial management, what it includes, the total scope of financial management, and everything. Now it's your turn that I have, given some questions. I've given the end answer of it, which help you to understand when you do the calculation that you have done the calculation correctly or not. And in the query session, you can ask me in case you find any difficulty to get these answers. So now we are done with this presentation. We have covered module 1 and we welcome the questions in the query session. Thank you very much to everyone.